How many love the anointing of the Lord? Hallelujah. Well, let's stand together. I pray that in this service today, there's going to be healing. There's going to be feeding of the Word of God to our souls in such a way that makes us strong, prosper, and fruitful. And I pray right now, Father, for the peace of God to come over your church and the power of God to come over this church. And we ask that you would inhabit the praises of your people this morning. Totally inhabit the praises of your people. I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that your Holy Spirit will in no way be quenched, but be received openly and completely in full manifestation today. I pray in the name of Jesus for sickness, cancer, anything that anyone is going through at this time, Father, be healed in the name of Jesus by the presence of yourself and your word this morning. I pray that our worship, Father, will begin to cause us to be undistracted, but focused in on the power of your presence this morning. Father, I thank you that these today are here to worship you with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength. I pray, God, that breakthrough for those who are needing some extra today, breakthrough for those who are needing jobs and favor and situations. I pray breakthrough right now, God, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Father, receive our worship this morning. We come to you with open hearts right now. Receive our worship, Father. Thank you for being such a wonderful, wonderful God of salvation today. And we want to give you thanks and praise because of who you are in Jesus' mighty name. Would you do that right now? Give him great thanks and praise. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Now when they drew near to Jerusalem and came to Bethphage, the Mount of Olives, then Jesus sent two disciples, saying to them, Go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loosen them and bring them to me. And if anyone says anything to you, you shall say, The Lord has needed them, and immediately he will send them. All this was done that it might be fulfilled, which was spoken by the prophet, saying, Tell the daughter of Zion, Behold, your king is coming to you, lowly and sitting on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. So the disciples went and did as Jesus commanded them. They brought the donkey and the colt, laid their clothes on them, and set him on them. And a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road. Others cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. Then the multitudes who were with before and those who followed cried out, saying, Hosanna to the Son of David. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And when he had come into Jerusalem, all the city was moved, saying, Who is this? So the multitude said, This is Jesus, the prophet from Nazareth of Galilee. Yes. Then Jesus went into the temple of God and drove out all the who bought, brought, and sold in the temple and overturned the tables of the money changers and the seats of those who sold doves. And he said to them, It is written, My house shall be called a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of thieves. Then the blind and the lame came to him in the temple, and he healed them. But when the chief priests and scribes saw the wonderful things that he did, and the children crying out in the temple and saying, Hosanna to the Son of David, they were indignant and said to him, Do you hear what these are saying? And Jesus said to them, Yes, have you never read? Out of the mouths of babes and nursing infants you have perfected praise.
Hallelujah.
Then he left them and went out into the city to Bethany and lodged there. In the morning as he returned to the city, he was hungry. And seeing a fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it but leaves, and said to it, Let no fruit grow on you ever again. Immediately the fig tree withered away. And when the disciples saw it, they marveled, saying, How did the fig tree wither away so soon? So Jesus answered and said to them, Assuredly I say unto you, if you have faith and do not doubt, you will not only do what is done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, Be removed and cast into the sea, it will be done. And whatever things you ask in prayer, believing, you will receive.
Yeah.
Thank you.
want somebody to give God great thanks and praise in the house. Would you give it? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. He loves us. Hallelujah.
Well, good morning. All right, turn to somebody and say, get ready for the word.
Get ready for the word.
Father, I thank you, Lord, for this time right now, Lord. I thank you for your word. I pray, Lord, open our hearts and our minds, Lord, to receive what you have for us today. Lord, your word says if we ask for wisdom, we will receive it. Lord, I pray right now we ask for wisdom, we ask for insight, Lord, and we ask most of all, Lord, that our will be subjected to yours, that we will walk in it, love you, and love our neighbors, Lord. And it's in the mighty name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. About, I think it's been a couple weeks now, we had a holiday or semi-holiday called St. Patrick's Day. Now, some of you might know the true story, I'm sure a few of us do. However, I'm not really sure where the whole pinching people that didn't wear green came from, or the outrageous drinking and the advertising for drinking came from, but that has nothing to do with the actual day of St. Patrick's Day. So, St. Patrick was a saint. That might not be news to you. And actually, he gets established much before the process that the Roman Catholic did of sainthood. And in the 5th century, Roman legions withdrew from the farther reaches of the empire to defend the heart of Rome. Some of you might remember some of your world history. This territory of Gaul and further into modern-day England and the United Kingdom, the Romans withdrew from there to go defend the heartland of Rome. And at this time, the native Irishmen started to be emboldened, and they went along the coast in ships, actually raiding, pillaging, and taking slaves. One young slave was taken from England, and his name was Patrick. At 16 years of age, he was captured and made to be a slave in Ireland. He was in bondage for 6 to 7 years as a pig herder. And now, while Patrick had some familiarity with the gospel, records show us that his true conversion happened while he was in bondage as a slave. He turned to Christ and, I quote, "The Lord opened to me the sense of my unbelief," he said. He experienced true conversion, became a Christian, and developed a relationship with God. Even while he was abandoned to his own demise, it would seem, as a slave, that's when God appeared truest to him and he became a Christian. And a moment, 6 or 7 years down the road, an opportunity came, and Patrick was able to escape, making it back to his home in England. Now, that sounds like the conclusion to some great movie, etc., but actually, that's not the end of Patrick's story. That might be a great example of the saving power of God, but remember, when we become a Christian, it's not just about ourselves being saved or our own needs being met, for that process is just the beginning. As Patrick went home, and he, of course, was a Christian, and his father was involved in the church, and he was reunited with his family, sort of the happy ever after, seemed to be. But then God started speaking to Patrick. He started having dreams, and in his dream, he would see the voices of the Irish, and the voices of the Irish children would beckon him, pleading, "Come and tell us about Jesus." So after a series of dreams, Patrick decided to heed the call. He started hard into study and learning the faith as much as he could. And even though he still felt inadequate, he obeyed the call of God, left England, his home, and went back to the people that enslaved him to preach the gospel. I don't know about you, but that's a powerful story. And so his mission was so successful that later on, when we lose the record of him, we see missionaries coming back from Ireland to England. Just think about that for a moment. He left and went back to the people who took him captive as a slave, and so much of an impact he had that monasteries and churches were developed, sending missionaries back to England and even to Europe. Patrick truly risked his life believing that he would die a martyr, but had one of the greatest successes of any Christian missionary in history. Legends even say, we don't know this for a fact, but legends suggest that he had great miracles, even as much as raising the dead and healing many sick. His legacy caused missionaries to be sent around the globe, and people were to be inspired. And so, at once upon a time, a day was set aside to remember Patrick and his obedience to the call of God. Now, my question is today, and as my theme today is how is forsaken for us. Christ is forsaken for us. And then my question for us is, will we forsake our life for him? You see, what does it take to get true conversion when someone is willing to go to someone who enslaved them, who treated them like they are less than human, who took everything away from them, and share the love of Jesus? It is only true conversion that happens when someone realizes how much Jesus has loved them and receives Christ as their Lord and Savior, can a life be so transformed they have the impact like this. You see, this is the message of the gospel. The message of the gospel is good news. The word gospel literally means good news. Everyone say good news.
Good news.
You ever had news so good you were even willing to share it with people who you don't even like? Anybody know what I'm talking about? It's news that is so good. Now, sometimes you might do it on purpose because you want so-and-so to know how good things are going in your life. Right? I'm not really talking about that. Like, you know, you got new shoes and so you're going to flaunt it in front of your friend or your buddy, or you got this going on. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about news that is so good you're even willing to share it with somebody who you don't like because it's good enough for them too. You see, the message of the gospel and what Jesus has done for us is so powerful that it can take a heart that has been beaten and bruised and abused by the world, turn it around for the good of Christ. And I think at this time, it's good for us to remember, what exactly is this gospel? What is it that motivated Patrick? What is this message that he was willing to risk his life, that God wanted to use him to share? And so we look at the gospel is simple, and I know that in this church we are seasoning the word, but let's not forget how simple the message of the gospel is, and yet how powerful it is the same. Number one, all have fallen short of the glory of God, as the Bible says. Every person has sinned. Sin is separates us from God. Sin is something that goes against God's word. And remember, sins are not determined by our feelings or our interpretation of the Bible. It's the word of God that tells us what right and wrong is. And if there is a time when we need this message of the gospel in our country, it is now. If there is a time where we need people to recognize sin and its negative effects and have someone willing to preach the gospel, even if it's going to lead to their death or the loss of their prosperity or the loss of the good things in their life, that message of the gospel is so powerful and worth it. It is greater than I am. See, Patrick realized that the gospel was greater than him. The gospel is greater than I. So Jesus was forsaken on the cross for me. I am going to forsake the things of this world for him. And, you know, even just in the news, I mean, some of you, and I'm not going into detail with this, but if you just look at what is going on in our culture. What is going on? When you look at the music celebrities that are now put on the Grammys. When you look at the music videos that you can go on YouTube, and here's a little pet peeve of mine. You can go on YouTube, and I'm just looking at this deer hunting video by a Christian and clean, and he's just showing how to clean a deer. This is demonetized on YouTube. We can't have our children watching this. But when they can watch basically outright pornography because an industry wants to sell our children something, that is allowed. Let me tell you, that is the state we're in. We are in a culture, our culture is dead. That's really what it is. There is death in this world. There is death in the things that this world has to offer. But in Jesus, there is life, and life more abundantly. This is the message of the gospel. Everyone has fallen short of the glory of God. We have all sinned. Number two. All mankind has sinned and deserves separation from God, death and hell, because God is just. Hell is a literal place. Don't get into this neo-theology that wants to manipulate Scripture. Let me tell you, it's amazing. You go on YouTube, and everyone in the comment section is a theologian, a historian, and a professor. Everyone thinks they're an expert. The Bible says that in the book of Judges, everyone did what was right in their own eyes. What is right in our own eyes is sin and death and condemnation. But there is no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. Right now, children, those who are in school, your public school, your Christian school even, everywhere you go, Walmart is a mission field, y'all. Let me just tell you, we don't have to go anywhere. We don't have to go anywhere, but right down to Walmart, your public school, some of you, your family reunion might even be a mission field. Everywhere around us, our culture is screaming death, and people are accepting it, where we need to scream the message of the gospel that Jesus gives us life, that in Jesus there is no death. Even if we die, we will really live if we lay down our lives and pick up the cross and walk with Jesus. Because number three, Jesus has died in place of us. He has risen from the dead and conquered death, provided sacrifice as atonement for all of our sin, and has provided us a way of salvation because of his love. If we are willing to accept him and walk through Christ. You see, there is no other way. There is no other way. No good work is good enough. The Bible says our righteousness is of filthy rags. There is no other God. There is no other religion. There is only one way and one truth, and his name is Jesus Christ. He has died on the cross. He has conquered death, and he wants you and I to pick up and carry our cross with that message to everyone who is lost. This is the gospel. Romans 10:9 says that if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. John 3:16 and 17. I know most of us know this verse, but I want to point something out. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Now this is probably the most famous passage of Scripture that most people know. I think many heathens know this Scripture. I think you can see it on a bumper sticker. You can see it, at least here in America, all over the place. But let's go back to that verse 16. I want us to realize, I want us to look at something. There is no filler in the Bible. There's no extra words, right? There's no filler. There's no need for God to extend. Some of you know in college when you get done with your paper and you realize how short you are to the end of the page, you go back in and every little thing, let's extend it a little more. Let me expand on this. Let me look on the dictionary and the thesaurus.com and find, can I take this word and make it bigger and substitute with a bigger word? You guys know what I'm talking about. You go in and you search for all the periods to make every period bigger. Now, don't do that. That's a trick, but don't do it. You make every period bigger so that your paper is extended. You look for the biggest font. Well, see, the Bible's not like that at all. There's no filler in Scripture. And the Word of God is perfect. So we look at John 3:16. Does it say, for God loved? For God
so loved.
Now, let me give you a word picture here. It is not for God so loved the world. It is for God so loved. That's the picture here. God, because let me explain. Some of you love pizza. Some of you are like, we're doing this Lent thing at church, and whatever I do love, I'm going. Hurry up and get done, because when I get out of here, we get the break from Lent today. All right. Some of you love your food. Some of you love this. But God doesn't just love or like you and I. God doesn't just love or just like the people in this world. God so loves. So love is a very big emphasis. So love is going to the cross. So love is laying down my life and my will. So love is being willing to take on everything that you and I deserve, is willing to be given up, and a walk with God that you and I have never experienced was put aside for a moment, the sin of the world being laid upon by someone willingly, that is Jesus Christ, so loved you and I. Let's not miss the impact of this verse, because it's quoted so much. That is a crazy love. As the scripture says, there's no greater love than he that lays down his life for his friend. It is the magnitude of love through the sacrifice of Jesus and his resurrection of the dead that is our source of power, of love, and a sound mind. And the love of Jesus Christ will transform our lives and will transform the world. We don't need more politics. Can I get an amen, somebody? Amen. We don't need more resolutions in the world. We don't need a better system. What we need is the gospel of Jesus Christ. And we need not just a form of godliness and religion, but we need the power that comes through somebody's transformed life. When it gets a hold of you, you go back to your slave owners and they preach the gospel. When it gets a hold of you, you can be loving to those who spit in your face. When it gets a hold of you, you can put down everything that's important to you and walk in the fullness of the message of the gospel, that I don't care what happens to me, all I care about is being obedient to him because he loves me. That is the gospel. That is what we need. Hebrews 9:22 says, there is no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of blood. And as it is this time, it is Palm Sunday, and we're going into Holy Week. We are remembering, we are fasting and reflecting on exactly what Jesus has done for us. You see, we often say, or maybe just myself, Jesus died for our sins. But he did not just die for our sins. Jesus was forsaken for us. You see, when we go through the story of the Passion, Jesus was left alone to pray in the garden. Jesus was betrayed by a disciple. He was arrested illegally at night and falsely accused. He was betrayed by his own people and his own race. He was denied by his loudest supporter. He was scourged by the whip. He was humiliated in the holy city. He was crucified like a criminal and insulted during his death, abandoned by his disciples. All for you and I. All the law was fulfilled. All requirements of sacrifice was fulfilled by him. All things he chose to bear by will of the Father for us, undeserved by him, wholly deserved by you and I. Yet, none of these things are the worst. We're going to go to Matthew chapter 27. I'm going to ask that you stand for the reading of this word today in reverence and remembrance. Matthew 27, verse 32. Now as they came out, they found a man of Cyrene, Simon by name, and they compelled him to bear his cross. And when they had come to a place called Golgotha, that is to say, place of a skull, they gave him sour wine mingled with gall to drink. But when he had tasted it, he would not drink. Then they crucified him and divided his garments, casting lots, that it might be fulfilled which was spoken by the prophet. They divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. Sitting down, they kept watch over him there, and they put up over his head the accusation written against him, "This is Jesus, the King of the Jews." Then two robbers were crucified with him, one on the right and one on the left. And those who passed by blasphemed him, wagging their heads and saying, "You destroy the temple and build it in 3 days. Save yourself. If you are the Son of God, come down from the cross." Likewise, the chief priests also, mocking with the scribes and elders, said, "He saved others, but himself he cannot save. If he is the King of Israel, let him now come down from the cross, and we will believe him. He trusted in God. Let him deliver him now, if he will have him. For he said, 'I am the Son of God.'" Even the robbers who were crucified with him reviled him with the same thing. Now, from the sixth hour until the ninth hour, there was darkness all over the land. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, my God, why have you forsaken me?" You may receive it. And this verse in verse 46, my God, why have you forsaken me? I want to focus in on this today. You see, we've talked all about the things that Jesus has gone through. He became flesh. He walked among us. He left all the glory and goodness of heaven to live as a man like you and I. He went through all of the terrible things of life, including death. Yet, this was not the worst. Actually, the worst thing that Jesus experienced on the cross was being forsaken. It was these words, my God, why have you forsaken me?" that changed the heart of Martin Luther. Many of you might have heard of Martin Luther, the man known for starting the Protestant Reformation. Well, his story is somewhat relatable to you and I, perhaps. In a lightning storm, he was afraid for his life, and he made a vow saying, "If I will be spared from this death, from this lightning storm," must have been pretty bad lightning, "I would become a monk and dedicate my life to God." He made this vow to a saint, and whatever limited knowledge he had, he was an educated man, and he was saved from the storm. He did not die, and he became a monk. He did and became extremely diligent in prayer, fasting, vigils, reading, and other religious work. He believed in God wholeheartedly, but was very aware of his dust and ashes and sin. He always felt that he was a miserable and doomed sinner. So he became a very religious man, but had no relationship with Jesus. Some even say if it was someone could get to heaven just by monkery or by religious duty, he would have been first in line. But see, that's not what saves us. Good works, religion, church assembly is not what saves us. He was with his counselor confessing sins one time, and it has been recorded, and I quote, he said, "I do not love God, I hate him." You see, Martin Luther was all about the letter of the law and religion. Being a man of honor, he fulfilled a religious vow, but was missing the true conversion that only comes from our understanding of the love of Jesus and a relationship with him truly as Lord of your life. Luther was intelligent, dedicated, religious, educated. And as a matter of fact, before we see his true conversion, he ended up in a chair in the university for Bible study. Well, we would probably gather he wasn't even really saved. And we are living in a time where now, in our world, education is the premium thing. And let me just go ahead and tell you, a degree is not the same thing as education, y'all. There are some people with degrees that are stupid. And there's people without degrees that are educated. Education is something that only you yourself can do. I won't get too far into my philosophy here, but we have professors and teachers to help us along our journey. But we are responsible for our own education, especially in the Word. And you see, education now in our country is almost being worshipped. We're willing, as a matter of fact, we're even analyzing government action to pay for everyone to have education. Like that's going to fix our problems. Education does not save you. Being studied doesn't save you. Being pious and being religious doesn't save you. The Pharisees were all about religion, but they're the ones who had Jesus betrayed and crucified. You see, just the letter of the law killeth, but the Bible says the Spirit gives life. And no man knows Jesus but by the power of the Holy Spirit revealing it to him. We need to be seeking after Jesus and the gospel. All these other things, some of them might be good in proportion and moderation, but are not the solution. Education can't change our country. Education can't save your soul. Money can't save your soul. Success can't save your soul. None of those things, drugs, fulfillment, lust of the flesh, can ever give you true meaning and answer to the meanings and the questions of life. Only the gospel of Jesus Christ can save, can deliver, can fulfill our lives. And we are seeing this because what's going on with our young people? Education. And instead of being educated, they're being indoctrinated. And let me go ahead, parents, education of your child while they are still in your house is your responsibility. They are still responsible too, but the parent has to take ownership over your child's education, especially of the Bible. The Old Testament had it clear. Read day and night. Teach them these things. Our education is our own responsibilities, and while our children are not at the age yet of adulthood, we must take that step. We must fight for them, because the devil always is.
That's right.
And he doesn't sleep or rest.
That's right.
Think about that for a moment. We must fight for them, not just in religious liturgy either. Bring them to church, it's a command. Teach them the Bible, that's good. But we also fight for them in prayer. We also fight, and this is how we as the body of Christ need to act, because there are people like Luther who are being educated and missing God. There are people like Patrick who are being abused and experiencing injustice who need the gospel. Both of those type of people do. It is not simply enough to believe in God. James says the demons believe. Believing in God is not enough. We must truly give our heart to Christ and have conversion that comes through a relationship with Jesus. Because he was forsaken for us. We forsake our sin. You see, the world has a bit of an answer. And the best lie is a partial truth. And we are in a battle for the next generation and for this country. And we are in a battle as the body of Christ against powers and principalities and rulers of darkness in high places. We need to be warriors of the gospel. And it's not just education's good. Education's great. But if you only have knowledge and no wisdom, you'll be lost. The Bible says that if we ask God for wisdom, he will give it to us. And our children, right now, one of the most viral videos going on right now, if you haven't heard already, is a very popular rap artist for kids. And his new music video, he is a gay rapper that is, you know, dancing with the devil. That is the music video. And if you can imagine that, and I didn't watch it because there's some things you just don't need to see. All right. However, I was curious, if I click on the video, is it going to be monetized? In other words, monetized, do I have to sign in and be 18 to watch this video? Nope.
No.
Because it's an agenda on the lives of our kids. It's an agenda. We need to have our agenda. We need to quit being on defense of the church. I'm getting ready to preach now. We need to quit being on defense of the church. We are not to just play defense. Start with defense, that's great. But we start with defense, but we need to go on offense. It's not enough. You see, the church lost the education when years ago, when the church gave up in the Scopes trial, we gave over the education to the world. But that doesn't even matter, because the wisdom of God surpasses all understanding. We need to be warriors in the gospel. We need to be warriors in the prayer closet. We need to be warriors in the spirit. And let's no more play defense. It's time to go on offense and take back what the enemy has stolen from us. And how we do that is not with complicated, educated doctrines. Doctrine is vital and it is important. But the gospel by itself saves. You see, as Luther, being a highly educated man, missed the most simplest of things, the uneducated slave Patrick got. But when Martin Luther was hard at study with a bitter heart, he was studying, and he came across this verse, my God, why have you forsaken me? And the Holy Spirit moved his heart. You see, it was this very verse that led to the true conversion of Martin Luther. He couldn't understand. He thinks, I should be forsaken. I hate God. I'm a terrible person. I'm a sinner. Why would Jesus be forsaken? He's perfect. He's undeserving of it. He's done nothing wrong. He is God in the flesh. Why has he been forsaken? And he went deeply into studying. And Luther, he felt forsaken. He felt deserving of forsaken. But then revelation came to his heart that Christ, even though he was perfect and undeserving of any punishment, was forsaken in his place. You see, Jesus, there's more to the crucifixion than just a Roman execution. Jesus on that cross was forsaken for our sin. We cannot fully understand this, as many will point out too, that this is something that's beyond our understanding to understand fully. But what we do know, Jesus knew the light of God's countenance. He walked with God in a way that you and I cannot yet and can never truly do, because he's never had a beginning. He had walked in the light of God's countenance in a level of relationship that you and I never have. Yet he experienced being forsaken when the sins of the world were laid upon him. You see, even those in hell do not know what it's like. Because, you see, every person that winds up in hell has rejected God out of their own self-worship and their own self-created misery. Their love of sin, their hatred and rejection of God, their hard heart led them into the place where they are. Even they don't understand. You see, Jesus, out of his love for us, willingly experienced this. Being forsaken for that moment on the cross. Walking forever in a relationship with God and walking away from that for a moment out of undeserving, willing, because of his love. Nobody on earth can understand this. And it spoke to Luther, and it should speak to our hearts, that Jesus' experience on the cross was agony beyond comprehension. The nails and the whip, yes, but the most detrimental feeling ever experienced was when Jesus felt forsaken from God. Now, of course, the Father did not stop loving the Son, but Jesus was in some capacity separated, where he could not feel the love of God or feel the manifest presence, feel the love and the feeling he had always had been with God. And he walked willingly. Jesus said that nobody takes this from me, that I lay it down on my own accord. Jesus said, no one forces me. He asked God, let this cup pass from me. But he said, not my will, but your be done. You see, Jesus, going through his mind was not just the pain and the suffering, but the joy that awaited on the other side of the cross. And it was that crazy love of the gospel, the good news, that brought him through it. For the Bible says, he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Jesus took this cup and willingly drank it out of his love for us. This is the message of the gospel. For God so loved the world, he willingly took the sacrifice because of his love for us. You see, just as Martin Luther, just as others in this room, just as we, but when we really think about it, that's why sometimes we have to go back, as the Bible says, go back to the joy of your salvation. When we are tempted to despair, when we are feeling overwhelmed, go back to the joy of our salvation, because this will radically change your life when you embrace and allow it to move into your spirit and your heart. It can change the most bitter of hearts. It can change the most destitute of hopelessness people. It can change any life. It is the power that brings life into us. The death of Jesus on the cross, his resurrection, brought Luther to true conversion that led him to do great things for the church. It brought Patrick to conversion. It took Paul, who was willingly trying to kill and arrest Christians, and made him the most powerful Christian that we have seen. This is what turned our mourning into joy. This is what turned sin into goodness of God. It is the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. He died on the cross not just for the global people. It is a personal. Jesus died for you. Yes. Jesus died for me. And yes, I believe even if it was just me, he would have been willing to do it.
Amen.
This is why Paul said in Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, For it is the power of God to salvation. For everyone who believes, for first the Jew and now the Greek. See, everyone who believes can experience this power. That's why I'm flat-footedly Pentecostal, because it's not just a religion, folks. It is a power that comes through being filled with the Holy Spirit that can change lives, that can set the captives free, that can keep you from sin, that can deliver me from bondage, that can break the addiction of pornography, that can break the addiction to drugs, that can take those back. And even that man who is, that rapper in that video who is dancing with the devil, God, and I pray that in the name of Jesus, he gets set free, because the power of the gospel can change him into the most powerful Christian on YouTube.
Amen.
Jesus did this for us, conquering death for all. This is why Paul said, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection. You see, that moment of him being forsaken, the darkness came, and it was in the middle of the day. That's why I encourage you, come with us. I know most of us are probably seeing it, but come with us this Good Friday and let us watch the Passion of the Christ together. He was forsaken for us, went through something incomprehensible of suffering. See, Jesus literally experienced hell on that cross. It's separation from God. We can't even fathom that. Jesus has asked us, pick up your cross and come with me. You know what the difference is? If you are in Jesus, we'll never have to experience that. When you are in Jesus, he's already paid the price. He's already gone through hell for you and me. We don't have to. He wants to set you free. And nothing in this world can take that away from you. They may kill this body, but Jesus said, I am the resurrection and life.
Yes.
He that believes in me will live, even if he dies.
Yes.
Then we're going to get ready. We're going to get ready to take communion in remembrance of this today. And next week at Easter, you know, Easter really, we focus on the joy of the resurrection, and we should. And actually, we should do that every day, even today. But today, as we go into Holy Week, we are also remembering the price that Jesus paid. When we take communion, you see, Jesus said, this bread, and we're going to be passing out the communion and just wait a few minutes. We're going to do this all together in just a few minutes. But as we get ready to break bread together, Jesus said to do this in remembrance of him. What did he mean by that? Well, first he talks about the bread. You see, this was prophesied in the Passover that the lamb would be slain. And the blood of the lamb, when it's laid on the doorpost, spares you from death. That lamb had to be killed, and its blood put on the doorpost for the plague of death to pass over. Actually, just before this final plague, darkness came. Some wonder if that's perhaps why the darkness came before the cross. Of course, we know that when God had to be separated from Jesus in that moment in some capacity, it brought truly dark. Jesus felt that darkness, and that's why he quoted the psalm when he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? You see, Jesus felt the human, while being fully God, he was also fully man, experiencing death. So in just a moment, we're going to receive communion. And the Bible teaches us, we do this in remembrance of him, that the bread represents his body. That the grape juice, the wine, represents the blood that is shared. We're going to do this a little different today, and you can go ahead and get it ready. Remember that top layer breaks, removes the bread, the clear. And then we're going to do this in just a moment, a little differently. But before we go into it, the Bible also says, before you take communion, before we break bread, we are to self-reflect. Is there anything in our lives that we need to make right with God? And actually, communion is not for those who aren't in Christ yet. Actually, communion is not for sinners. But if you need to make something right, now is your opportunity. Do not wait. We've received the message of the gospel. If you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart Jesus has been raised from the dead, and you follow him as Lord, not just Savior. Lord means he is the leader of my life. I'm willing to follow him. I'm willing to trust and obey him. I'm going to read the words of this hymn that we might know. It was written by an Irish woman who actually is believed to have been widowed more than once. In that era, she was widowed. That would be a very big sense of hopelessness and despair. But yet she wrote this hymn. Her name was Charity Bancroft. Before the throne of God above, I have a strong and perfect plea. A great high priest whose name is love, who lives and pleads for me. My name is graven on his hands. My name is written on his heart. I know that while in heaven he stands, no tongue can bid me thence depart. When Satan tempts me to despair and tells me of the guilt within, upward I look and see him there who made an end of all my sin. Because the sinless Savior died, my sinful soul is counted free. For God the just is satisfied to look on him and pardon me. Behold him there, the risen Lamb, my perfect, spotless righteousness. The great, unchangeable I am, King of glory and of grace. One in himself I cannot die, my soul is purchased by his blood. My life is his with Christ on high, with Christ my Savior and my God. We're going to watch this video, and I'm going to ask that during the video and music, everyone's going to partake together, then we'll close in prayer afterwards. This is your time of reflection between Christ. Remember that his body was broken for you, that he was forsaken for us. Remember his blood was shed to set us free, and he rose from the dead and fights for us.